Right, welcome to evidence-based audio engineering and sometimes education, pipeline audio. This is number 166, and this is leveling up in the loudness wars. I don't know if you were super young, maybe you never heard of the loudness wars, or maybe you haven't heard so much about it lately if you're older, but there's some things to talk about again. First of all, we got an announcement here. I've got a new channel that's actually just evidence-based audio engineering on YouTube. And I'm going to start moving the episodes to there. I'm not sure if I'm just going to do it through a playlist or if I'm actually going to physically put copies of all the episodes on there. But it's going to be a lot less cluttered than my other channels. It's just going to have the show information, whatever. If we do some live streams, maybe we'll be on there. But the first video uploaded there is a roundtable, if you haven't seen it, between with me, Ethan Weiner, and Glenn Fricker. And if you don't know Glenn Fricker, I hope you do. Spectre Sound Studios is probably the most popular recording channel on YouTube. I mean, I know there's others with more subs, but they don't seem to have so much impact when it's specifically about recording anyway. I guess you could take that up and argue that thing, but it's kind of a polarizing channel, but I love it, and it's nice to be on a show with Glenn. And it's a round table I wanted to do, mostly to do with audio myth busting. And to me, Ethan Weiner is the James Randi of audio, and we were able to get him on the show as well. If you don't know Ethan Weiner from the forums, you know, he started Real Traps. He's the world's preeminent acoustician popularizer. Anyway, he's the kind of the Carl Sagan of acoustics. He's got a book out right now called The Audio Expert, and I highly, 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 highly recommend you guys read this thing. Ethan's kind of the guy who really made a lot of us think about just what do we mean by fidelity? What do we mean by good sound, bad sound? What is transparency? And many of the things we talk about on this show a lot, Ethan has long been a popularizer of doing actual tests to figure out what the true nature of these things are. To me, you know, I kind of have a bent that I don't like people buying stuff they don't need to buy, and I really hate when people tell people that they have to buy something that they really don't need, something that might actually make things worse. And you know, this was a great thing to have Glenn's popularity. I'm hoping we do more of these. We hopefully will. If we don't, I'll just keep I'll try and do a roundtable with other people. I've had Ethan on my show before. And you really should go back and check that out. I'm not sure which episode that is. I'll link it when I get a chance. Anyway, this was the first roundtable. Glenn called it Don't Get Mad, Get Evidence. That's pretty smart. And so let me see the description here. First episode of an audio myth-busting roundtable with me, Ethan Weiner, founder of Real Traps, and Glenn Fricker. I'll be moving the regular evidence-based audio engineering episodes to this channel soon, and then there's some links so you can see Glenn, of course, at Spectre Sound Studios, and Ethan over at ethanweiner.com, or go to Real Traps, or and especially get that the Audio Expert book. It's on Amazon, I think. There's an ebook version of it if you want that, which is, you know, probably that way you can search it. You know, that's kind of a good thing. I'd like to get this channel kind of moving. You can see right now there's no subscribers, there's two subscribers. Interesting. But, you know, there's no real views or anything. This is evidence-based audio engineering. Please, you know, like, comment, and subscribe. And I'll try and I'll make you this promise. You guys beef up this channel, I'll keep the nonsense off of it, and I will just put on the final episodes and whatever else you guys think I should put on there. How about that? Here's Glenn's channel, Spectre Sound Studios. I think the thing that really made him popular, to me anyway, was this stupid text from musicians to engineers. That stuff is hilarious. It's stuff that you know, we didn't have YouTube back in the day, but I used to answer these kind of questions all the time at the studios. And I tell you, my favorite one of all is, I got a guy who called and said, do you guys record rap? And I said, yeah, we record anything, you know, really. As long as it's audio, we record it. And he says, you guys got time to do a rap session this week? And I said, yeah. And he says, well, how much will you pay me to spit my rhymes? So that was when, that was the one I got back in the day. You know, these rappers asking if you're going to pay them to rap. So anyway, and here's Ethan's book over at ethanweiner.com. And, of course, Real Traps, you know, I'll learn about. In fact, in this room and every other room that we have here, it's the acoustic treatment that we do have is all based on things Ethan suggested over the years. And it's not that he's some guru. He is a guru. It's that he promotes common scientific sense, and all the principles that he works on are just principles of science, of the science of acoustics. So next thing is Sound on Sound. I know that it seems like they've gotten a little bit wooey over the last couple of years, but you know, they're still great. And I don't know if you know about this, but Sound on Sound has a glossary. Just soundonsound.com/glossary. And I mean, everything's in here. When you have a question about stuff, at least if you need to know the name, the real words, like the definition, at least to start up where to go looking for more information about this stuff. I'm just going through A right now. Let's see. So we got A-type plug, A-weighting, AD converter, alternating current, AC coupling, accent miking, acoustic envelope, acoustic foam. Let's see what they say about that. An open-celled expanded polyurethane or melamine foam that allows sound waves to enter and flow through the foam to dissipate their energy and thus prevent the sound waves from being reflected. The density and depth of the foam affects the frequency range over which it is affected as an acoustic absorber. Acoustic treatment, active loudspeaker monitor, active sensing, ADAT. How about that? ADAT light pipe, additive synthesis, and different AES standards. After fader listen. I mean, this goes through, and we're just at the very beginning of A. So do yourself a favor, bookmark this glossary, because if you've got any questions about stuff, there's a good chance that you're going to learn something about it from their glossary. It's awesome. I had a site called Reference Guitar. It was on a server that crashed, and I had something similar for guitar stuff, but maybe one day I'll go and start a new one, but I'm so worn out lately, I can't really do it. But this glossary is awesome, and it's better than the one that I had. So, okay, so let me read you this headline. It's from Production Expert, Tuesday, 5/10/22. It says Apple chews minus 16 lufs loudness level for Apple Music, and here's why. So if you don't know what lufs are, that's the loudness units. I think it's spelled out in AES EBU R128. Is that right? Let me look at that up. Lufs. In fact, that should be on the the Sound on Sound. Let me see if it's a R128 though. Let's see, lufs. Yeah, it's a PDF from the AES or EBU. Yeah, R128, loudness normalization and permitted maximum level of audio signals, EBU recommendation. So this was 2020. That doesn't sound right, because we've had lufs for a lot longer than that, haven't we? No, we've had this for a very long time. Something's okay, yeah, first issue 2010. And we really thought that was the end of the loudness wars. And if you don't know, the loudness wars were audio, it was just getting compressed to insane degrees, where we're ending up with just these bricks of the songs, no dynamics, no nothing, just this loud brick, like everything typing in all caps. And there didn't really seem to be a way around it because people were terrified of being quieter than the next band. And with the loudness units, it seemed like we were going to move away from that, but I don't really think we have. Anyways, so Apple's, a lot of the fight that you hear around these, this loudness standards and stuff is what level to be at. And people are mastering for different things. Most of the streaming services, I think, will just turn you down if it's too loud. I don't think they'll put any weird kind of processing on you unless they need to turn you up. As far as I know, I'm not 1,000% positive about that, but I've listened to like really influential mastering engineers talk about how just master it for the quieter stream or whatever. And I don't know that that's right. And I've seen it pointed out that, you know, because they're just going to turn down the louder guys, it's still so hard to decide how loud you want these things. And honestly, when we get masters back, they're pretty much mashed up. I don't see the brick thing going away, but it's nice to see that Apple's moving this range down. You know, I don't know if in Europe it's a little bit different now. There's supposed to be laws against this, but if you ever seen the you know, where you tilting into the TV in order to hear what people are saying, and then the commercials come in and just annihilate your ears, just blasting loud. That's kind of what this is about, or at least that's the legalese of why this became a political issue. This, but in terms of our music and stuff, ideally, if as this level gets lower, we should have some room to move around, but I'm not really sure that that's true. Production expert says that they have a lot of coverage of loudness wars. Let's see what they have to say here. Loudness, everything you need to know. Some little bit of stuff about the Fletcher Munson curve. Anyways, let's just read a little bit. The ideal is simple enough. Just like a human listener would turn up quieter sounds and turn down loud ones, loudness normalization does exactly that. Because loudness is a perceptual rather than a directly measurable parameter of the audio file, like the peak sample level in old school peak normalization, a method for reliably measuring perceived loudness needed to be developed, which was far more difficult than it sounds. But once BS-1770 and the loudness unit was developed, and that's where the LUFS are loudness units, the mechanism to automatically match the perceived loudness of audio became doable. But, you know, I'm not sure if they're going to cover this or not, but loudness is insanely hard to measure. Like, are you talking about the loudest thing that ever happens in a song? Are you talking about this 30 seconds or the next 30 seconds or whatever? So they have all these different parameters that go into what they call loudness. And you can see that this can still end up with a pretty bad measurement. But most of the times it's pretty good. And there's even there's some websites out there where you can just upload WAV files or MP3s and stuff, and it'll tell you what the streaming services will do to your stuff, whether they'll turn it up or turn it down or whatever. I forget the name of it. We mentioned it before in the show. If you search, you'll find it. So let's see. So what loudness do streaming platforms use? And this is where all this arguing and stuff really, really comes in. Says over the last 5 years or so, Spotify, YouTube, Tidal, Amazon, and SoundCloud have all settled on a LUFS normalization value of minus 14 LUFS. And if you guys have ever seen the K metering system, you can, you know, man, I'm sure I'm going to get a whole bunch of pedantic nonsense shot at me, but you can roughly calibrate to that. So minus 14 LUFS would be basically your K14. I know I'm going to hear this, but bear with me. In relative levels, this is going to be, it'll make sense. Anyway, Apple has announced their LUFS target to be significantly quieter at minus 16 LUFS. However, by choosing minus 16 LUFS, Apple has taken on board the recent AES TD-1008 recommendations. For completeness, it should be mentioned that Spotify also offers a minus 11 LUFS loud option, and Deezer normalizes to minus 15 LUFS. What is Deezer? There's so many of these new things. I don't know who's who anymore. Here's AES 10008. So their recommendations here, this is chapter 4. For the following recommendations, distribution loudness is not to be targeted to the upper tolerance, C5. Normalization, C5 normalization principles for a discussion on the lower tolerance and normalization practices. It's really cool when the AES gives you some idea of what you should do with normalization. I'm not always 1,000% with them, but in general I am, and I'm probably wrong when I'm not. So it says, dialogue integrated loudness measurement is recommended as indicated in table one. When not possible or applicable, integrated loudness measurement is recommended. So integrated loudness, let's see if we can like to get there without losing this page. Let's see. Integrated loudness, the average loudness between two points in time measured electrically using the BS-1770 loudness algorithm with gating. To estimate the integrated loudness of a continuous stream, it is necessary to choose a sliding rectangular integration time window long enough to prevent the measurement from being disturbed by short-term dynamics in the content. I hope you get that. What they're saying, let me see if I can get back to that chapter. Oops, I knew I shouldn't have messed around. If you haven't seen this stuff before, there's a free one. There's a freemium anyway. It works perfectly good, but you should buy the pro version just because it's so cool. Uline has a Uline loudness meter, and this will show you the short-term, integrated, a bunch of other parameters and stuff. I pretty much only look at the, I use this for leveling Helix presets, for instance, guitar volume presets. You can see what this is. You can see that the integrated and the short-term are a little bit different. The integrated, it takes into account time. It takes into account gating, which I think usually means that the stuff that's really quiet is going to get ignored and not going to be part of it. But that last bit about it, when they're talking about how you don't want short little bursts to really impact your integrated loudness time. So it's like I said, it's really hard to measure this stuff. But here we go for the recommendations. For all content, it is recommended that the maximum true peak level not exceed minus 1 dBTP. I have no idea what dBTP is. I hope that's something like dB full scale. See? At the codec input of lossy encoded streams. At the codec input? Interesting. So this is before you turn it into an MP3 or whatever. See section 7BP control for further explanations. Anyways, when I look at the assorted thing right here, it's saying if the speech volume is measurable, and here's a footnote. This is why this stuff is really complicated. This applies when speech, music, and effects elements are produced with reference to a speech anchor. So if speech is measurable, the distribution loudness is minus 18. And that is something that people have been talking about for podcasts for a while. They're saying, like, you know, podcasts kind of sounded too loud at that minus 14. And minus 18 might be the way to go. I don't know. It says if speech is not measurable, you know, like they said earlier, use the integrated loudness, again, though, at minus 18. And the upper tolerance, they're doing plus 1, plus 2. You guys know where we, on audio, we usually try and keep that thing way below. Well, actually, we can keep it from right near negative 0.3 dBFS. So everything kind of gets squished up to that little bit there, right? But for music, track normalized, and the footnote for that says, minus 16 applies when practicing track normalization, see music streaming services. Track normalized is minus 16, and that's using integrated loudness. And album loudest track, e.g. on-demand music services, they're saying minus 14. Interstitial content like commercial advertising, public service announcements, promotional material, political advertising, and the like, minus 18. Thank you. Virtual assistant, minus 18. Thank you. So they're actually showing to put music a little bit louder than, or could be a lot louder. Like, you don't think that minus 0.3 would be that much. Like, you're not going to hear 0.3 of a decibel in a mix. But squishing everything to that by using compression, you're going to be significantly louder than if you just had something that wasn't all super squished and got to minus 0.5 or something. It'd be a huge difference. And so when you see this minus 16, minus 18, minus 14, I know, yes, it's only 2 decibels. It's a lot. Think about guitar power amps, right? If in order to make it twice as loud, that's 6 decibels, right? You need 10 times the power. So the difference between a 10-watt guitar amp and a 100-watt guitar amp is 6 decibels. Let me know if I got that wrong. I think that's right. So this is what we're talking about. The loudness wars are still going. And now it's interesting that Apple went lower, though. So let's look a little bit more down here. Soundcheck is now on by default on iOS devices. Blah, blah, blah. What does this mean for engineers? Apple is too big to be ignored. Yeah. Every time they change their ports and their software and break everything for everybody, it's true. They're too big to be ignored because they keep breaking everything. But this, I don't think this is a bad move this time. This move brings consistency, but no convergence to a single universal level. The obvious move, considering the current landscape, would have been for Apple to choose minus 14 lufs. But considering this move to negative 16 lufs, and for every extra reduction in lufs comes with it an accompanying headroom bonus opening up more dynamic range, this is a welcome move. The fact that the new level is lower is also interesting because it would appear that Apple is taking on board the excellent work done by the Audio Engineering Society. Thank you. Let me bring in the actual experts for once, Apple. Good job. To help understand the issues, we asked Bob Katz and Rob Byers, who are part of the group that drew up the AES recommendations, both the original TD-1004 and the revised TD-1008. Now, is Bob Katz the guy who came up with the K system? I think it is. So you guys are about to yell at me. Let's see. Katz, K metering. Yep. That's Bob Katz. So, anyway. It's gratifying to see Apple take a lead and start the trend to drop the target loudness for streaming services. Let's hope the other services follow Apple's lead. However, that is very far from inevitable and for the time being remains a hope on my part. Anyway, okay. So what does this mean for us? Because like I said earlier, people are still cranking the hell out of it and just letting the streaming service turn it down. It says, does this mean I should be mastering for minus 14 and minus 16 lufs? So while products that allow service-by-service auditioning of what you master will sound like at the normalization levels of different streaming platforms, to do this exhaustively might be to be missing the point. Mastering engineer and loudness expert Ian Shepherd, Ian Shepherd is one of the people who was saying, he's got the mastering show if you ever listen to that podcast, proposes an alternative approach which matches my own experience. He suggests concentrating on the short-term loudness rather than reading and monitoring the integrated value. He suggests going no louder than minus 10 lufs in the loudest sections. He also stresses the importance of true peak levels. The significance of peak levels can't be overstated as loudness is relative, but peaks are absolute. The reason this is as important today as it is today is for the variety of different encoding algorithms audio is likely to pass through as it propagates through various streaming platforms. In the old days of lossless PMC audio and CDs, peak levels could be pushed very close to full scale. That was that minus 0.3, right? Exactly how close was a point of contention, but close nonetheless. In these days of MP3, AAC, and other lossy algorithms, depending on the algorithm used and the bitrate chosen, the maximum peak level before distortion varies, and between 1 and up to 3 dB of clear headroom between your true peak level and full scale is recommended. That's a lot. So now when you're talking minus 14, now you're talking about 11 decibels, right? I mean, you're not, it's not as much headroom as you thought. So, let's see. How loud your mix is of secondary importance to the internal dynamics of the mix, and that's the whole point. Well, that's what we like to think, but I'm not really sure that the world is ready for dynamic music again. I don't think this article doesn't really answer what this is going to mean for us. And I think maybe we should be checking out the mastering show and see what Ian's got to say. And not just him. I think there's a lot of voices we really got to listen to here. As for me, I just mix an album and I send it off to my mastering engineer. And I know it's terrible to kick the can down the road, but he knows what to do. And those guys can fight over it. Just want to do a quick note that, I've been doing a lot of stuff about Helix and Line 6 and everything lately. There's some pretty significant bugs that I've been finding in the Helix software, for the hardware units, HX Edit, and, on the unit itself. I think, we have a lot of problems where, things are overwriting saved stuff without you wanting to, values changing without you changing them explicitly, and then now even some pretty serious bugs where the USB disconnects depending on what you do with the software. And I've been sending in bug reports. Sometimes they can repro them, sometimes they can't, but if you're a Line 6 user, I'd really appreciate some backup, and maybe you could let me know and see if you can repro some of the bugs that I'm getting and help share these with Line 6. 3.2 or whatever it is probably not coming out till summer NAM, probably maybe even later than that. So we really need some bug fixes before then. Let me know. If you're a Line 6 user, please let me know, and we'll try and work on this. Okay, next thing here is, hearing it again. Jitter, 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 jitter. All these people are comparing different audio interfaces and telling the noobs they got to go buy some really expensive one because of jitter. And I guarantee their cheap interface and their expensive interface that use the same drivers, by the way. Remember that? We've said that on the show how many times? As if they're really going to have different levels of jitter. But to me, it was always about whether or not the jitter even mattered. Here's a company that sells clocks, so of course they're going to make the biggest deal about jitter in the world. So he says, jitter can only be considered totally inaudible if the worst-case jitter introduced sidebands are at least 23 decibels below the A-weighted system noise. Above this level, jitter may be audible or may be masked by the program audio. And so let's go look at this A level, which is actually in the SOS glossary. So it's A-weighting anyway. Electrical filter, when used taking measurements of equipment designed to mimic the relative insensitivity of the human ear to high and low frequencies of sound pressure levels. So it's kind of like a flipped Fletcher-Munson curve. But I don't know what they mean by system noise. If you mean, shot noise down at the resistors or whatever, fine. That would be insane to get that level of jitter. I'm just saying your background noise. I think... not that you can't hear through noise, but generally stuff that's below the actual background noise, it's not really going to matter much. I know there's those old examples of taking a fading out cymbal and not dithering, and then just keep turning it up and keep turning up the output of the recording. And pretty soon you're going to find a spot where you really do have that quantization error. And that's where you really, in fact... it's a good experiment for you to actually listen to what happens there and compare dithered and undithered. And you may not care. And I share most of the real world stuff. I don't care. There's a at Audio Science Review. There's a little discussion about, the audibility of jitter, and, one person, an admin, says, audibility of jitter highly depends on what profile it has. Dolby did some tests a few years back and found that pure sine wave spectrum jitter can be audible in the few nanosecond range. And there's an AES paper, Theoretical and Audible Effects of Jitter on Digital Audio Quality. and they're dealing with the threshold of audibility. And he gives this explanation. The people who make statements about the inaudibility of jitter usually don't know what jitter is. And that is not one thing. It's an infinite number of things. It's like saying that bacteria is dangerous to you. That is only true of some bacteria and a certain amount of it. But the jitter that the clock is supposed to clean up, that's the jitter they're talking about. Let's not no true Scotsman this or move the goalposts anywhere. That is the jitter they're talking about. Whatever the clock guys, the clock magic people say that they're going to clean up. And so I like this response by Crabapple. People who say that usually ask for examples where jitter audibility has been demonstrated using a commercial music release and or hardware. That's what I ask for. And that's why I always say if something manifests in the real world, it can be measured in the real world. We may not know how to measure it right now, but it can be measured. And something like jitter, which you can reproduce over and over and over again, and you can measure. Let's hear, just like Crabapple said, let's hear an example where jitter audibility has been demonstrated using a commercial music release and or hardware. I haven't seen it. Have you? Give me an example. So he continues. Jitter audibility is a case, again, of quantity as well as quality of distortion. As in, no one says X can't possibly be audible. X doesn't exist. X can't be measured. But measuring a difference doesn't mean hearing one. And how many times have we gone through that? So during all this crazy DAW nulling stuff, sometimes you might have a slightly different dither system or whatever. And the DAW's null to like minus 144 decibels. Fine. You tell me, let me see you pick out which one of the two that's different. The only difference is down 144 decibels. If you can pick that reliably, pick one of these guitars, I'll give it to you. Yeah, and we know this challenge has come up so many times, and I still have all my guitars. Okay. But how often is X high enough in practice with the sources and samples we use? Yes, I can make pathological files where you'll hear, you know, not just jitter. I guess you could make jitter, but I could make it so that the dither would matter. I could make it so sample rate would matter. If you're really trying to torture the stuff, but it's not in any way you'd actually use it in the real world. CD player jitter, for example, is typically measured in picoseconds, thousandths of a nanosecond. Maybe as per B&G's 1998 work that you cite, the next time I'm listening to pure sine waves at 8 kilohertz on different gear, preferably 90s vintage, I'll watch out for jitter. So, again, jitter is not one of the parameters of the audio interfaces you're buying for your first interface, for you're doing your first podcast, for recording your ukulele solo or whatever else. It's not a parameter that matters. Modern gear is so good. Don't worry about it. And the people who shout the most about this are either trying to sell clocks or can't hear it themselves. It's the typical forum parrots that just say nonsense they heard before and just repeat it. Give me 1 second here. All right, sorry about that. The vampires are requesting my blood again. Okay. Where were we? And a jitter. Oh, all right. There's a post that came up on the gear page, and I don't know why I hang out here. I mean, the moderators kicked me out for asking for evidence. You know, it's crazy things happen. But I really like this. I really like this forum. Aside from the Dunning-Kruger dorks, but this is a pretty good question. Read this. So the title is, why care about how accurate an amp, cab, or IR is if it's being played through something else? There's the eternal debate on whether or not we've actually achieved the same sound coming out of a speaker simulator as a speaker. I say for the most part, people aren't going to be able to tell the difference. But there's a bigger question to me is that why do we think that the real amp is the better sound? You know, I'd take consistency. I know what it's going to sound like each time. I think that's in some, you know, I could call that better. I can make sounds in the digital world that you can't make in the hardware amp world. I'd say that that's better. So it's really hard to say why something's better, or, you know, I mean, it's subjective, of course, but there's just this attitude that it has to be better if it's real. The tube amp has to be better. I don't think so. I've never been as happy with my sound as the sound I get from plugging my guitar into a computer. And I'm sure that makes me some kind of noob or, you know, whatever, but it's true. But let me read what he said. So he says, sorry if this question is not really for this section and hope no one is offended by it as I'm just trying to learn. And see that this is the kind of thing that we're in. You know, any political discussion, any discussion about anything, actually, you got to put these disclaimers in because somebody's going to get offended. And this is nothing to be offended about. This is an actual question about a technical thing. This is not something to preach about. It's just like when somebody asks about drum samples and everybody starts preaching at them, right? And we've actually spoke about that many times on the show, too. But I'm just trying to learn. As a person new to modeling devices, I see a lot of time and energy in the work put into and discussions of just how accurate an amp, cab, or IR sound, and especially a certain device or purchase patch to the thing is supposed to sound like, and especially for IRs, how much work goes into recording them accurately. But my guess is most of us are going to be playing through these through something that is probably going to alter that tone or sound, isn't it? I.e., if what you're wanting is the most accurate and classic sound of a Fender Bassman or Deluxe Reverb, but you're playing that through a brand new Matchless or Orange amp, wouldn't I be correct in suspecting it's not going to sound exactly like one of those Fenders or anything like the sample clips you may have heard? I guess one thought I had was that some are using these directly into a recording mix of some kind, as that would make more sense, and then perhaps the other extreme right into the house PA, if you're playing someplace that has that. But as I have to imagine that the majority of people are using these through something else, then why does anyone care just how accurate it is to the real thing? There's like a lot of good points in here. And, you know, so if you are recording it and your simulation sounds just like the real thing, then it's perfect, right? It'd be the same as recording the real thing. You're fine. Same with the PA system. If you're able to give the PA the sound of a mic'd up amp or whatever it is that your whole chain. And that, again, this is why I like the modeling stuff better, because you can have the whole studio chain right there and you hand that to the sound guy, the compression you wanted, all these post effects that we do in the studio. You guys with your magical guitar tones, I mean, we've gone through this a million times. That's not the sound you hear on the record. That's not the microphone. Microphones aren't ears. That everything about a microphone, moving a microphone 1 degree has more effect on your sound than changing speaker cabinets. That, I go without question, that's true. Moving it an inch has more effect on the sound than changing a speaker cabinet. So just the microphone itself is completely changing everything about your sound. And then after that, you know, forget the recording medium. Once they're mixing, they're making room for all the other instruments. So it's not just magic guitar sound. That magic guitar sound is all kinds of modified before you hear it coming out. So anyway, you know, in general, I think if you were to play, I mean, think about it as like your studio monitors, like, yeah, whatever you mixed, it's not going to sound exactly like it sounded in the recording studio that they mixed it in, because you got different speakers and you got different acoustics. But relatively, you should still, you know, if you play different music through your monitors, it should still give you the same type of relative changes and relative effects that you'd get in the original studio if you played your stuff through there. So it's the same kind of thing. But yeah, if you're purposely trying to change it, like I get, like somebody just had a link up for an FR system, that where the claim was, some of you guys actually like the sound of a tube power amp and traditional speakers. I'm like, well, that's not full range flat response, is it? If you're changing the sound, if you're trying to change the sound, it's not, that goes out the window. So, I mean, this is a really good question, and I like that he's asking it, because you know, you guys think you're you got this so close, so much the same. And again, like I said, I'm not really sure that the real thing is better, you know, even though that's the claim all the time. And some of the answers up. IRs are not supposed to magically turn your $14.99 Logitech USB computer speakers into a 4x12 full stack. They're supposed to recreate a recorded guitar sound in reference to other recorded guitar sounds or recorded sounds. That's where you go. Yeah, and Laksu says, us end users should be more concerned with questions like these. Do I like this device? Do I like how this device sounds and feels? Does it have the features that make it work for my uses? Playing at home, playing in a band, complex use scenarios where quick and easy switching between sounds is important. Is it easy for me to get the good sounds I want out of this unit? Yeah. So that's what I think we should be worrying about. Most of the other stuff is, here we go. Accuracy matters to me only when a piece of gear claims to be accurate. But even if it claims to be accurate, what does that mean? Accurate, like, where are you standing? If you move, like we are talking about moving mics, Ethan Weiner has a really good video where he puts a bunch of balloons up and he finds all the standing waves in a room. And there's two of these balloons that are like right next to each other. Like you move your head, you know, a couple inches, and there's something like a 30 decibel swing in the response of a certain frequency. So what do you mean by accurate anyway? If you're changing only one variable, fine, but we can get there. I know you guys don't think so, but, well, that'd be a good test for another show. Maybe we think about that. I know I want to keep going on about these guitar stuff, and I know this wasn't originally much of a guitar channel, but you know, this helps us the same critical thinking that you're dealing with. So there's another post. Modeler outside can never replace my 4x12 cab and 100-watt head. You know, never say never, right? And what does that even mean? So here's the, I'll read what he had to write here. Use my Fractal FM9 last 2 gigs to save tube life on the head and for ease of packing in and out. If I like the sound of my tube amp, whatever, I would just bring it. Like, I don't understand this stuff. Save the tube life. Yeah. Inside it was fine, but outside, man, it was a letdown. With my in-ear monitors, it always sounded good. That should be where this post stops and the guy deletes it and says, wait a second. Sounded good in my in-ears. But the guys were like, dude, where's your crushing thick tone? How have you all made a modeler work outside? When I have heard them use live, it's usually a massive line array, so it's able to push plenty of air. There you go again, answering the question. Listen, if it sounds good coming out of the speakers, I don't care if you're inside or outside, it's not your modeler's fault. If it sounds good in the if it sounds the same in the in-ears, inside as it does outside, your modeler's doing what it's supposed to do. It's your PA system that doesn't have it. And this idea that, oh, if I had just had this loud, loud amp, it would be okay outside. Take your take a whole stage full of 4x12s and then go play a big festival. It doesn't even have to be that big. Just your basic, like even out at a rodeo or whatever. Nobody in the audience, maybe somebody at the very front row, maybe is ever going to hear your amp. Your amp is not going to be loud enough to play. I don't care how many 4x12s you got. Nobody's hearing that out there. The PA system is what's boosting that. That's where you got to go. It's just so weird that people are so digital phobic that they'll blame any problem on something that just doesn't have it. So somebody said, use your tube amps. But here we go with some decent answers. And, you know, this I've got most people on ignore, so, you know, who knows what else was put on here. And I got them on ignore for good reasons we talked about in other shows, right? Is your front of house guy on board with getting a good tone? I'm not into the tube modeler debate, but modeling does have a very consistent sound. It should crush outside if it's doing so inside. And that's true. Somebody else, sounds like the PA is too small to fill outside. It's not the fractal's fault. That's on the PA system. Somebody else says, don't bring a knife to a gunfight. In my experiences, outside gigs with loud acoustic drums on a big stage require a loud amp or you just don't cut. Unless your PA is very good and the tech team is also very good. But that's not, again, you're not going to hear the amp. So talk about EQ. Somebody else said, did the PA guy agree with you on what your guitar tone should sound like? Some would high pass a guitar, leave space for the bass instruments. Somebody said, should have brought a quad cortex. I always boost the mids when doing outdoor gigs with the modeler and PA only. Seems to help a lot. And it says, who was complaining? So this is Dr. Frankencopter, okay? Who was complaining? Audience or other bandmates? And doesn't this say more about the mix than the source? Yes. Like I said, if you sounded good in your in-ears, that's what it is. Let's see. So Stokely says, we do a mix of outdoor and indoor. Stage is always silent other than drums. Drummer doesn't own knee drums. And like we're always talking about keeping the stage volume down. In fact, I got a set of practice cymbals coming that's going to go in my downstairs kit, and I'll be recording on that. And if it really doesn't work, I'll let you guys know. But I have a feeling that I'm going to like it for recording as well. Anyway, I watched a gig from our latest gig today. Sounded pretty much like a mic'd guitar amp to me. Volume comes from the PA. Volume comes from the PA. And we and the sound people we work with are happy with that. You do whatever works, though. More than one way to be successful. Since at least half our gigs are on small stages with volume limits, it's easier just to stay consistent and go direct all the time. These guys, I mean, that's really what we've been trying to do for forever. But, you know, there's always Murphy's Law that gets in the way, right? Years ago, some sound companies expected an amp and wanted us on wedges. Now we are finding they have no problems with direct and often expect us to be on in-ears. One recent gig, they knew four of us were going on in-ears, and they handed us four wireless packs when we got to stage. They told us the Wi-Fi password, and we had known to get the app for their mixer, and we had to control their monitor mixers. Kind of like we're doing with the XR 18s out here. You could conceivably control your own monitor mixes with those. A lot of people do. But again, putting a giant loud amp on stage, it's not for the audience. That's for you to hear. And like we always say, keep that stage volume down. When the stage volume comes up, that's where all the problems come from. I like that a lot of these guys are using the in-ears and stuff now. Somebody else says, I only use tube amps. As if tube versus transistor matters. That's why we have this show, right? But if your tone is different when you go outside, then it's a PA issue. Yep. I always put my modeler through a tube amp. That seems to make the difference between a so-so tone and a good one. This is one of these parrots, right? The real solution here is a tube PA. There you go. Here we go. This has absolutely nothing to do with your fractal and everything to do with the environment in front of house, period. Your fractal is not just somehow crushing on a record and crappy live. Do other bands have that issue that have been using Modelers Live for over a decade now? The answer is no. Taylor Swift's band sounds good to me. Carrie Underwood's, yep, they sound insane. Huge Metal Axe, yep, sounds sick live. These bands all have amazing engineers, absolutely, but they also use their tool, their digital product, in the right environment to fit the job. Don't use this as a pillar to stand on that digital can't do what a tube amp can, because it's just not true at this point, and that's coming from someone with 8 tube heads, 7 4x12s, and no digital products. However, I did gig exclusively professionally with nothing but a Kemper and did for over 600 gigs. The problem is the PA. Were there front fills? Did this guy actually know what he's doing? There is absolutely no doubt that for smaller club gigs and gigs that rely on sound from the stage, that yes, a tube amp or a digital product with the power amp and a cab is better the choice. It's just physics. I don't even know that. Well, then the direct, sure. But you could use a PA speaker for your modeler. Buying a digital product like a Kemper or a Fractal does take more thought and preparation and understanding of acoustics when playing a live venue. I don't know about that. There's also no doubt about that. I don't think so. And I think this has comically been blown over as something you really need to consider. The greatest live tone I ever had was my Kemper direct into the front of house system that comprised of an insane line array in front of 25,000 people outside. It was glorious. Your problem is not the Fractal. Your problem is not choosing the right product for the environment in which you are performing. I don't know that that's even true itself. I think the problem is the PA. Anyway, that's enough for this week. Okay, so please check out the evidence-based audio engineering channel. Subscribe to it. I'm going to start moving everything over to that channel. So please, please, please use that channel and pump it up so YouTube stops messing with me. Thank you. I'll see you